Thank you, Bart. Good morning, everyone. So it's a pleasure to be here, and thank you for inviting me over to Philips and to the Philips offices here in Paris. And so I'll try to talk in the next 90 minutes about strain imaging, assuming that you're not familiar with it. So in that sense, I go back to the basics. And so I hope there is not too much redundancy for most of you. Otherwise, just signal me like, Jan, this is too basic, and then I'll go faster. So the subtitle of the lecture is Doppler or speckle tracking, or both. And so along the way, I'll try to effectively address that question. Now, before we get into it, and Bart already elucidated on it, why are we interested in the first place in myocardial strain imaging? And, well, we could do an entire lecture about that in itself, but I tried to summarize it here in this one slide. Essentially, we know that the function of the heart is to pump blood during throughout the body. And the way the heart is able to do that is by changing the cavity dimensions during the cardiac cycle. And if we look where that cavity dimensional change in the end comes from, it's really from forces that are developed at the molecular level between actin and myosin proteins. So essentially, if we do want to understand how the heart is able to beat, and whether if we try to assess whether contractional forces developed by the heart are normal or not, we do want to look at the myocardial properties as such. And we could, in a very simplistic way, say, well, if we look at local motion and deformation of the myocardium, it enables us to study the local contribution of that piece of heart to the overall ejection and filling of blood. It's definitely an oversimplification, but it gives some kind of rationale, indeed, why we would like to look at local motion and deformation of the muscle. Now, the entire lecture is about strain imaging, so I think it's critically important that we are all on the same level or nomenclature in terms of strain, because, as most of you will know, even in engineering, there is different ways of defining strain. And so in the cardiac literature, we have also a set of definitions that I'll quickly walk through so that we all start off from the same definitions. So obviously strain, typically referred to with the Greek symbol epsilon, is the deformation of an object with respect to its original shape. So very simplistic, if we have a 1D bar, length L naught, it deforms to length L, then we simply say it's the amount of deformation or length change, L minus L naught, relative to the original length of the object, L naught. So in that sense, it's obvious that this is a distance divided by distance, so the units is dimensionless. And it's most often expressed in a percentage. Now, of course, we, particularly in the heart, we don't necessarily want to express the strain at the end of the deformation process, but we may want to express the strain at every time point during the deformation process. So in that sense, we could express the strain dynamically, just using the exact same expression there. But now our length becomes the instantaneous length, so L dependent on T. And we see that as the object is deforming, as the myocardium is changing shape, we can instantaneously express the amount of strain relative to the original length of the object. So in this example, we go from no strain at all at the beginning to 0.4. And so that would be 40%. Now, of course, in reality, things are more complex. So we can not only have lengthening and shortening of an object. If we go to 2D, then there can be the left, or we can have the shear strain, so the sliding of one side with respect to, which are four different components of deforming this original square object. And so we can combine these four fundamental modes of deformation into, in different ways in order to describe in the end any kind of deformation of that two-dimensional So those four numbers, those four strain values, are then typically entered into this strain tensor. In 2D, that would be a 2 by 2 tensor. And we indicate with subscripts deformation component referred to. So where the crossed or the mixed indices typically then refer to the shear strains, and the repeated indices refer to the normal strains or the pure strains. In 3D, I didn't try to make these animations. It would be too hard for me to do. But I showed a couple of examples here. Of course, if you have a cube, you get even more modes of variation in 3D. So we end up, if we want to have this 3D deformation, end up with the pure strains on the diagonal, and then the off-axis or off-diagonal values being the shear strains. So sliding of one side with respect to the other. Now, probably all of that was old news. You have seen many times before. Of course, when we move these definitions from mechanics to the heart, then it also makes sense to make it more adapted to the heart. And so rather than talking in a Cartesian coordinate system about XX, XY, whatever strain, to a more physiological coordinate system, which is defined as the radial, longitudinal, and circumferential system, and is defined locally at every point of the left ventricular myocardium. By definition, the longitudinal direction is tangential to the epicardium from apex to base. So that's this one. Will be also tangential, but obviously orthogonal then to the previous one. And the radial axis is orthogonal to the epicardium, and so orthogonal to the previous two, so that you get the right-handed coordinate system. So if we use that coordinate system, then we can express, just as before, the deformation modes of a piece of myocardium. But now we end up with typically these indices. So we have the RR strain, which is nothing but the wall thickening. So it's the normal strain compared to the radial axis. We get the CC strain, which is nothing but the circumferential shortening. We get the LL, which is nothing but the longitudinal shortening. And then we have the shear strains, which have the mixed indices. So for example, RC, which is the sliding radial direction of the, in the circumferential direction, radial component. We get the CR, which is in fact the same. We get LR and we get LC. So it's really the sliding of endo to epi from this little piece of myocardium with respect to that piece. So when we talk about cardiac strains, we don't normally express, some papers don't. In a coordinate system that makes physiological LC system. Just for mentioning it, I'm not going to elaborate on this, but of course you know there is a thing like called a matrix diagonalization. So where we can make sure that the non-diagonal elements become zero, essentially what we're doing is locally rotating this RLC coordinate system so that the shear strain components become zero. The ones that remain on the axis, on the diagonal, we then refer to as the principal strains. And so you see quite often, especially in the mechanical literature, discussions about the principal strains. The reason to introduce them is that they, well, if you go to stress strain analysis, as there is a lot of strain components that are zero, the equations get simplified quite a bit. The disadvantage, I think, of that system is that the meaning of these principal strain values is hard to get unless you also understand how this new locally rotated RLC coordinate system is in fact oriented. So I think if we want to do principal strains, we as well need the principal axis. You present it in a different way. Right, principal strains. So, again, if you do not agree or you have comments or questions, you can interrupt. No problem about that. Next to strain, we have the concept of strain rate. It was already discussed a bit in the session this morning. The concept is very easily illustrated in this animation. So both of these are lengthening by 40%. The strain is 40%. In the top animation, that deformation takes 1 second. In the lower one, it takes 2 seconds. So the deformation rate is different. And we just say that the strain rate is nothing but the strain per unit of time. So we get something in the unit per second. Top one would be 0.4 divided by 1, so 0.4 per second. So the bottom one, 0.4 divided by 2, 0.2 per second. Of course, 1 per second is also hertz. So you could say, why do you call it per second and not hertz? I guess in principle it's the same. But on the other hand, I think hertz has the connotation of something cyclic. And that's naturally not necessarily so for strain rate. So for strain rate, it's more common to refer to it as per second, or if you would like, percentage per second. All right, so far for the definitions. Now let's go to the real topic of the talk. So how can we try to measure strain with ultrasound? And first thing I popped up was this slide from Continuum Mechanics. And I'm not going to go through these expressions. You may have seen them before in some mechanics books. But essentially what is most important is that the strain that you see here is actually derived from this tensor C, which then comes from F, which is the deformation gradient tensor. And this is a lot of spatial derivatives. So in essence, what these equations are saying is that if we want to assess strain, we do need to calculate spatial gradients in motion. So if we want to measure strain with ultrasound, essentially what we need to do is estimate the motion field, and then from that motion field, try to get all of the required derivatives in order to get to the strain. If you look carefully in this definition, in fact, we are deviating from what I put in the beginning, where I said L minus L naught over L naught. That's not what is listed here. And that's already like different ways of defining strain. Here we see, actually, this is the length after and before the deformation process. So we see here they use the length squared, which is actually quite common in mechanics literature to do. The essence of this slide is really that if we want to go to strain or deformation, essentially we have to measure a motion field. And so this principle is illustrated here to make it very easy to get. If there is no motion gradients, like in the top animation, then there is essentially no deformation. It's just a pure translation of the object. If we do have motion gradients, as in the bottom, then it has something to do with the deformation. And so that's what our continuum mechanics equations say. And it's also very intuitive this way. Of course, if we think of motion, because it all now comes down to motion estimation, then, especially after Damien's talk, we immediately think of Doppler. And so that's what also the people in the field of strain imaging did. They had their Doppler systems that were available, either a pulsed wave Doppler system, as shown on the left, or a color Doppler system, as shown on the right. You have seen these kind of pictures before. And so what you could do is use the exact same measurement principle, but try to exploit the fact that myocardial tissue and blood tissue moves at different velocity ranges. The blood moves quite quickly throughout the heart. The muscle that sits around the blood moves relatively slowly. So we could try to tune the filter settings and try to focus on the Doppler shifts that are associated to lower velocities rather than the higher velocities to look at the myocardial motion. In addition, we know that the blood is relatively little reflective. It's relatively little echogenic. That's why it appears black in the image. Like if you look at the RV, it's black, while the muscle sitting around it is grayish. So it's more echogenic. So that's the other property we could use and say, well, let's look at the slow-moving tissue that is relatively echogenic. So then if you start tweaking the filters of the Doppler system, there is nothing different about the technology behind it. It's only the filtering of the resulting signals. Then you get these type of images. And so that's been done now more than 20 years ago, initially by a French person. I'm not sure if he was an engineer or a cardiologist. But that was for the pulsed wave Doppler system, where he then managed not to measure the velocities of the blood, but rather of the myocardium. Damien also showed this type of profile before. And then Norman McDicken and George Sutherland in Edinburgh They did that early 90s for color Doppler and then got the color tissue Doppler, so color TDI. So if we now remember that we could use this trick from mechanics, so just look at the spatial gradients in order to get to strain, then of course we could take our color Doppler dataset where we have a spatial distribution of instantaneous velocities. We can apply a spatial gradient operator, so remember this animation, locally. And if we do that for every pixel in the image or every pixel of the myocardium, then we would end up with a map that is related to the deformation. I didn't go through the mathematics in detail, but if you would, then you would see that we don't end up by doing the velocity gradient with the strain, but we end up with the strain rate. So we end up with the instantaneous deformation of that piece of myocardium, which can be put in a color code, whatever color code used. So back then we used this gray, green, yellow color coding, which is pretty bad for me because I'm partially colorblind. So for me, that's all the same. I'm not sure if there is any gradients in there. but then once we know the instantaneous strain rates, of course, we can say, okay, let's see what happens during the cycle, and we just accumulate instantaneous deformation rates in order to get to the total amount of strain during the cycle. So that's the sequence of processing that, according to theory at least, should work if we believe in the mechanics literature. Now, does it work? Well, of course it does. We and others elaborately tested in all kinds of settings, so in kind of very simple gel phantoms that we could cyclically deform, where we, from M-mode measurement, could see what the true deformation is, and then through the Doppler gradients, we could also see what the estimated strains were, and that seemed to fit quite well. We could go to animal settings where we had independent measures of local myocardial deformation. That seemed to do a good job. Also, when we move in vivo and we try to compare against other imaging modalities like TAG, MR, it seemed to do a pretty good job. So yes, this methodology seemed to work. So for the ones of you that have never really seen such curves, this is what they typically look like. So let's first look at this apical four-chamber image. So where we have three samples taken along the septal wall from apex to base, and where we see, after calculation of the velocity gradients, that we get negative strain rates during systole. So that means, by definition, that the segment is getting shorter in dimension. That's what you expect during a normal beating heart. So during ejection, during systole, the base is moving up towards the apex. So we do expect these negative strain rates during ejection phase. Then we come to aortic valve closure, which is the end of the ejection phase, and we have these biphasic positive strain rates, so the biphasic lengthening of that piece of myocardium. Biphasic, because you have the early relaxation phase, then for a little while nothing much is happening, diastasis, and then there is the atrial contraction that fills up the ventricle a little bit more and blows it up like a balloon passively, so you get a little bit of further stretching of that myocardium. So that's this bump. So if you go through the integration process from the strain rate curve, you end up with these strain traces that look like this. So you see the continued shortening of the segment throughout the ejection phase. It reaches its minimal length at end systole, and then it lengthens during the early filling. There is nothing much happening during diastasis, and a little bit further lengthening during atrial filling, to return back at zero, the original length that was there at the beginning of the cycle. That's what you would expect. The values that have typically been reported in literature, because we get this entire curve, we get it in 18 segments, so it's a lot of data to interpret. But the values that in the end were often extracted from these curves and reported in papers were the peak value of the strain rate during systole, the value of the strain curve at end systole, defined as the moment when the aortic valve is closing, and potentially there, in some cases, pathological cases, you get continued shortening of the muscle after the aortic valve has already closed, and so that value, which is then referred to as the post-systolic shortening or the post-systolic strain, has also been reported in multiple studies. If we want to do this in practice, there are some things to consider. First of all, when we acquire the data set, we have two options. We can either go for an M-mode acquisition with color superimposed, or we can go to a B-mode acquisition with color superimposed. Both of these approaches have been used quite extensively in many studies, and they both offer advantages and disadvantages. Of course, if we go to an M-mode acquisition, we get very high time resolution, and that's very nice. Ultimately, if we would like, in an adult heart, we could go to 5,000 measurements per second. Typically, that's limited by some of the safety measures, so typically, effectively in the system, it's more like 1,000 measurements per second, but theoretically, we could go to 5,000. Of course, what we then do during acquisition is that we pick one line somewhere in the 2D ultrasound image, and we constantly image that one line. Of course, the heart really doesn't care about where we put that line, so the heart will be moving left, right, up, down, wherever it likes, and we are only visualizing the same spatial location, which may be different anatomical locations during the cardiac cycle. So that's the disadvantage of this M-mode approach, where we do get very high time resolution, but we cannot really correct for motion of the heart, and therefore the curves that we extract do not necessarily make physiological sense or physical meaning, because it could be that we are extracting this velocity gradient from different anatomical locations, and in the end we're just summing it all up to get the strain curve, but it becomes something not physical. So in order to tackle that problem, of course you can go to this B-mode acquisition. There you are able to try to track your region of interest throughout the cardiac cycle, so to avoid this anatomical issue. But of course, then the dataset comes at a lower time resolution. And so what is better to use has been maybe a matter of flavor and interpretation, or maybe it depends also a bit on the application that you have in mind. But as good compromise, in Belgium we like compromises, often people said, well, let's then go for a narrow angle 2D image. So it's somewhere in between the true full 2D B-mode image and an M-mode, so a narrow sector angle. Whatever is done, it's important to, during acquisition, to keep the PRF of the system very low or as low as possible in order to get the best possible time resolution. So we didn't really go in depth about the effect of PRF on the velocity estimates, but one can show that if you lower the PRF, that your velocity resolution is better. So you can discriminate between smaller changes in velocity. Now another thing is practical. I said, well, we then just calculate the gradient of these velocities. As you without doubt know, if we try to do gradients numerically, it can be a nightmare, because if there is a little bit of noise in our data set, it gets amplified and things explode. So in order to get around that, what then is done in practice is a lot of smoothing, essentially. So we can smooth the velocity data set initially, so by implying a 2D mask, we could even smooth it in the time dimension by a certain amount of pixels that can be chosen. And in the end, in order to do the gradient, we don't just take two values and divide by their distance, like shown at the top, but we rather do a regression through a small region, so we do a least square estimate of the slope of the velocity gradient, so we do a least squares gradient estimate. In the end, what was also typically done in the Doppler approach is to capture a couple of cardiac cycles, and then we average the result, or the resulting strain or strain rate curve, over all cycles recorded in order to try to reduce the noise and get a better SNR. And I'm mentioning this explicitly because that approach, I think, was very wise, and it's kind of forgotten with the introduction of speckle tracking. A third problem that we meet in practice is that typically, if you start integrating the strain rate curve to get the strain curve, you do not nicely return to zero at the end of the cycle. When I gave you the example in vivo, I said it starts off at zero and at the end we go back to zero. That's what you expect because the length of the myocardium after one cycle should not change. In practice, it does. Of course, there could be a bias in our velocity estimate. There could be a bias in the gradient or in the strain rate estimate. So if we start accumulating, then of course this error gets accumulated as well. And so this is something that you would typically get if you do not do anything about it. So you see that after one cardiac cycle, we drifted here by 25%, which in this example is quite significant. So what we could do is to say, well, from physiology, we know that there should not be drifting. So we just correct for it. And we say at the end of the cycle, the strain value has to be zero. And we divide the error that we made equally over the entire cycle. Everyone was equally guilty. And so we subtract and do whatever necessary to correct for this drifting. Although I think this approach has now been established, and it seems that few people are still questioning whether we should do this drift correction or not, I think it's still wise to keep it in mind that there is a drift correction involved. And I'll come to speckle tracking later on. It's embedded there in the algorithms as well. At the time, which is now quite a long time ago, we had a lot of discussion about this. Should we correct for drifting, yes or no? And some people argued, yes, we should correct for drifting because physiologically it's not possible that you end up at a value different from zero. Although that could be argued during a respiratory cycle, there is variations during of instantaneous segment length. So maybe there could be small changes in length at the end of the cycle. But they should not be 25%, that's what I showed, that's for sure. On the other hand, some people argued, no, we should not correct for this because we don't know what we are correcting for. So maybe we do more harm than good. And there is something to say for that as well. And just as an example, at some point, one of the cardiologists I work with tried to take three patient groups. It doesn't matter which groups were involved. But he tried to measure what he called the end-diastolic strain. So it was just the amount of drift at the end of the cycle. And he could see that this amount of drift could very nicely separate his three patient groups. So although from engineering we said, no, this is just measurement error, forget about it, he kind of ignored that comment and he just looked in his patient population whether it had any diagnostic value, and apparently there was. So the drift was related to his patient populations. Could be. So there could, for sure, there was very likely an indirect reason, but still, it kind of showed that maybe it's not always wise to just correct and forget about it. All right. Now, of course, there is also some problems with this Doppler approach. And as Damien already mentioned, Doppler, and we all know, Doppler only measures the velocity component along the image line, so in the direction of wave propagation. If we have a velocity component orthogonal to that wave propagation direction, it's not picked up. So this means in this extreme situation, in this cartoon, that if a piece of myocardium is moving this way, depending on where we put the transducer, we'll get obviously a different projection. And in this extreme example, for the basal position of the transducer, we would measure a positive velocity towards the probe. And actually, when we measure for a more apical position, we would measure motion away from the probe, so a negative velocity. So that's very annoying. And of course, as we do the spatial gradients based on our Doppler data set, this angle dependency is inherited in the strain rate estimates and in the strain estimates. And so this is an example from Jens Uwe Vogt, also a fairly old example, but where you would think that piece of the wall here is yellowish, so that would refer to shortening, while another piece of that same wall is bluish, so it's lengthening. So you would think maybe there is something wrong. No, this was a healthy volunteer. Everything was shortening, and this is merely due to this angle dependency that gets inherited. Now, in practice, you could get around it, and you should not necessarily panic. if we are careful during acquisition. So if we know that we can only reliably measure the component along the image line, then we could just make sure that this image line nicely aligns with the physiological dimension that we are interested in. For example, if we want to access the longitudinal shortening lengthening, we could try to make sure that our image line is nicely aligned with the wall. If we want to get the radial thickening or thinning here of this posterior wall, we could try to make sure that the image line is nicely perpendicular to the wall. So by being careful during acquisition, we could somehow avoid the problem. Another problem with this Doppler approach is that, as I already said, based on the MOAT acquisition, if we want to do a meaningful physiological or physical curve, then we have to make sure that we follow the same anatomical region throughout the cardiac cycle. So in practice, that means that if we place a region of interest here at the base, that we would have to make sure that that region of interest stays in this anatomical neighborhood throughout the cycle. And in the Doppler approach, there was no real good method to do this in an automatic manner. So what happened is that the physician had to follow that point of interest throughout the cycle on the B-mode image manually. We developed some tools based on two orthogonal M-mode lines that would facilitate this tracking so that you do not have to put this dot on every single frame. But still, it was very cumbersome and time-consuming. So based on these pitfalls of Doppler, it seemed that there was space or room for improvement and that we should do better. And particularly this problem of the angle dependency and the manual tracking actually in the end come down to the fact that we only measure one component of the velocity vector. If we could get the velocity vector field, then we could obviously automatically track the region of interest inside the 2D image, and we could do the gradients properly and avoid angle dependency. So one way to go to 2D velocity estimates is to use vector Doppler, a fairly old technique that has been proposed a long time ago. So essentially where you try to do this type of assessment, so you measure from two different angles, the same point of interrogation, and then you can combine your measurement to get your velocity vector, very trivial. If you want to make that practical, then you integrate these two transducers into one, so you bring them closer together. If you have a linear array, you use the left hand to look under one angle and the right hand to look under another angle, and you combine your components into your velocity vector estimate. And that works pretty well. The problem is that if the angle between these two acquisitions becomes narrow, so if this angle alpha here is limited, it's kind of intuitive that your estimate in your velocity vector becomes larger. And so for cardiac, we have the restriction that we have to image the heart in between ribs, so we cannot use very big transducer apertures. And so as the footprint of the transducer is restricted and should be small, this angle will intrinsically be relatively small as well, which makes it very hard to get very good velocity vector estimates using this multi-beam Doppler or vector Doppler. Nevertheless, people have tried it for cardiac as well. As far as I'm aware, there is one publication from the team in Lausanne. I think it's Lausanne. And they showed quite nice results using that vector Doppler approach. No questions so far? No? Everyone who is still with me? Okay, go ahead. For this vector Doppler, the bigger angle, the better. So ideally, you would have 90 degrees, and that gives you the best. To make it still practical, I'm not sure. Maybe I'm going to look at Odile. Do you know? 20? 20 or more. Yeah. So I would.
It's
better. Yeah. So above 20, let's say. Okay. Any other questions? No? So then let's move on to speckle tracking. So vector Doppler could be a solution towards the problems of the Doppler approach, but maybe it's not the most practical because of noise in the 2D estimates. And so speckle tracking was proposed a long time ago as well. I think the first publications were actually from coming from Canada, the team in Montreal with Jean Meunier, who did a lot of this in his PhD work, but most of it was only reported in French, and so somehow some of his activities did not ventilate to the rest of the world. But essentially what in speckle tracking we'll try to do is to say, okay, let's forget about Doppler, and just say we have two images within a cine loop taking shortly after one another. We pick a region of interest in one image, so that's characterized here by this grayscale pattern, and we'll try to localize that same pattern in the follow-up frame. And then if we find somewhere that same pattern in that second image, we assume that the underlying tissue has moved accordingly, and so we have our 2D velocity vector. Now, is this a reasonable assumption? Can we assume that the speckle is preserved from one frame to the next? Well, then we have to go back to the physics of ultrasound, and I think Olivier has maybe shown similar things, so where the speckle originates from. In a very simplistic model, we could say that the RF signal, the echo signal that we obtain, is really the summation from individual reflectors sub-wavelength that we refer to as scatterers, small inhomogeneities in mass density or compressibility. And so if our tissue contained six scatterers, like in this example, then because of path length differences to each of these individual scattering sites, we would get an echo signal from each of these sites at a slightly different time instance, just because of the geometry of the problem. So if we sum them all up, then we would get the interference of all these scatterers. That's our RF signal, that's our backscattered signal as we measure it. Now, if we then do this thought experiment and we say, okay, let's have our piece of tissue with six scatterers move away from the probe, then essentially we see that the absolute time delay to receive echoes, of course, will increase because the wave has to travel further to meet these scatterers and come back. But the relative difference in echo, so the relative phase shift between the contributions of each of these scatterers, is effectively not much influenced. There is, of course, this small angle change, so that will contribute a little bit to shifting of one echo to the other. But on the overall scale, that's negligible, especially if this tissue is a little bit further out from the transducer. So that means that, indeed, we do expect in this thought experiment, we do expect the exact same RF signal to appear in our ultrasound line, but a little bit downstream, so deeper down. If, on the other hand, our tissue is moving orthogonal to the image line, so orthogonal to the wave propagation, of course, if we were to repeat the measurement here, we wouldn't see anything because our scatterers have moved outside of the field of view of the probe. Of course, if you then move the probe to somewhere else, and we did that correctly, so we are exactly in the same position as where the tissue moved, then we would get the exact same signal back. So this moving to somewhere else, that would be a neighboring image line that we beamformed or imaged very briefly after doing the original image line. So from this very simplistic model and reasoning, we could say that, yes, speckles will be preserved under certain conditions. First of all, these scatterers should remain in the same relative positions with respect to one another. So in essence, what I'm saying is there should not be strain, which is a bit funny because we try to use it to measure strain. But at a very short time scale, maybe we can assume that there is no real strain in that piece of myocardium and that the redistribution of scatterers is negligible. Secondly, we should assume that there is no reangulation of the tissue with respect to the probe. Of course, if this piece of tissue starts rotating, then the relative contributions will change and our RF pattern is going to look different. And finally, we have to assume this is all illustrated in 2D, if this is really a 3D piece of myocardium, that the out-of-plane component is negligible. So under these three conditions, it should work. And actually, we can make sure that these three conditions are met if we make sure that the frame rate is high enough. What that means, high enough, we can discuss later on. But intuitively, conceptually, it's clear that if we simply do not give the tissue time to meet one of these conditions, we measure very quickly, then the speckle should be preserved. And we can do the tracking. Now, there are two very popular methods that are related to one another to then effectively go and try to do this pattern matching. One is called the optical flow methods. I'm sure most of you will have heard about that. So where we kind of assume that locally there is preservation of grayscale. And so if we see a change in grayscale in time, so the temporal derivative of the intensity, it has to be related to grayscales flowing in or out of that region of interest. So we see the spatial gradients in intensities appear here, and U and V being the velocities. Of course, we have there one equation. We have two unknowns, the U and V, the two components of our velocity vector. So we cannot solve that equation unless we put another equation in addition. And that's the boundary conditions. There are several boundary conditions proposed in literature. These are very two popular ones, the Lucas-Canate and Horn-Schunk, where we essentially also impose, for example, constraints on the spatial continuity of U and V. And so then we have two equations, two unknowns, and we can try to solve it. The technique that has become most fashionable or most used in practice is the block matching. And essentially what we do there is we use brute computer force. We don't do anything smart in a way. We just say, okay, let's take this grayscale pattern in one image, and we'll try to find it in the next image. And in order to find it, we just slide it over all possible new positions, and we express the local similarity of the kernel, so our red window, and the underlying image, the blue one. So that was obtained in the follow-up frame. The position where the similarity between these two grayscale patches is highest, we assume that our tissue has moved to. And so that's what we will see at the end of the movie. So here is high similarity, which occurs for that position. So that's where our kernel moved to. So both of these approaches have been implemented and seem to do a good job. The optical flow method, I think, again, came from Lausanne, where they... Unser is in Lausanne, isn't he? Yeah, yeah, so it was Unser's team in Lausanne. So where they applied it, the optical flow approach, in order to get 2D velocity estimates. And then the block matching approach has been dealt with by many, and I'll elaborate on that a little bit further. Now, as I explained yesterday during the hands-on, there is, in fact, a lot of design choices that we have to make. Which similarity metric will we use? How do we do interpolation for submotion or subpixel motion estimation? How large do we pick our kernel size? Many more design choices. And so there is a lot of implementations by many research groups and by many companies, in fact. And this is to show the latter. So I just showed five commercial solutions here from all of the main vendors, but there is more solutions. So in total, as far as I'm aware, there is currently 9 commercially available solutions for 2D speckle tracking. The main advantage is that it speeds up the analysis process. So you draw your region of interest, and you do not have to follow your anatomical region of interest throughout the cycle, because that's done intrinsic, because the 2D motion field is known. And if you like, as the 2D velocities are available, you can nicely project on the physiological longitudinal axis of your left ventricle, so you get rid of your angle dependency. So in practice, this is from GE. It's a movie that I had available. So how does it work? You take your image, you identify the region of interest. Well, first you make it recognize the view for chamber in this case. You annotate where the endocardial border is. You press calculate, and a little bit later, and this is close to real time. I think the movie is slightly sped up, but not a lot. So you do get your real-time tracking, or the tracking solution. It's not real-time, but fairly quickly. And you do get all of the strain curves. I showed these before based on Doppler, this speckle tracking technology.
The region?
Which one? This
yeah,
one?
Yeah, this one.
This is really this one unfolded. So if you pull it open like one straight line, and then you can look. So this is base, apex, base. So you do that base, apex, base. And then you see here the temporal dimension. So it's to get the time domain in there as well represented.
And here would you still, these parameters you explained earlier, the what was it?
And systolic strain, post-systolic strain.
Pre-strain, is it still validate? Are people still looking at this? Or is there, in the meanwhile, other parameters to quantify this curve?
There maybe should be or could be, but no. Mostly in literature, people stuck to the same indices, end-systolic strain, post-systolic strain. And I'll come back to that later on. We could think of peak systolic strain rate, but maybe we don't have the time resolution to do that. So it's essentially the same parameters that were extracted from these curves in comparison to the Doppler curves.
Then of course it's important where you put the boundaries, because this curve will then be different for different ROIs.
Absolutely, yeah, and that's one reason for variability in the measurement. Yes, and so I'll also come back to that a bit later on. Yeah. Other comments? Or? Okay, that same movie again. Right. So. The methodology has been validated as well in different kinds of setups. I'll not go to elaborate too much on it. So both in the experimental animal setting against independent measurements of local myocardial deformation, again against other imaging modalities like MR tagging. But importantly is that although I said there is like 9 vendors that have commercial products on the market, only a couple of them have really gone through this validation process and have really shown that the measurements that you get out are somehow related to a reference standard. And so some of the implementations, in a way, remain unvalidated. Nevertheless, as I commented, there is a lot of design choices to be made. And so in that sense, it's not because one vendor managed to make speckle tracking work that it implies that the other vendor, with other choices and another implementation, will get equally accurate or good results. So I do think that if there is a new solution proposed, that it should also be extensively or correctly be validated. But that's unfortunately not the case in current literature. Now, of course, we know that there is also volumetric ultrasound available. We can acquire 3D data sets. So intuitively, we don't see reason to believe that we would not be able to do the same trick in 3D. So we could take a 3D cube of data and try to match it in a bigger 3D cube and see where it matches. Of course, this increased field of view does not come for free. We pay a price, and the price we pay is the space-time resolution of the data set. So particularly the time resolution aspect, remember that I said the speckle is preserved if we have high enough frame rate. So if we now go to 3D and we say, okay, this increased field of view will be possible, but at the cost of time resolution, we may start running into trouble with our assumption that speckle is preserved. Nevertheless, it's worth giving it a go, and so that's what several people did. I think Jonas Crosby in Trondheim was the first one to do this in vivo. He managed to get indeed 3D motion estimates from these volumetric data sets. Conceptually, there is nothing different from 2D. To make it work in practice is really all about computational time. The computation times go exponentially up. But in as such, there is not a real problem. And so currently, there is also a couple of commercial solutions available. I put three on the slide here from three of the major vendors. For completeness sake, I should also have added an example of TomTech, who is also, it's a software-only company. They also have a 3D tracking solution. But unfortunately, I didn't have a movie right available. So, but there is four commercial available solutions to 3D tracking on the market. And so two of them, I'm sorry, two of them, as far as I know, have been, solidly validated, or at least in invasive open chest animal setups, where we see again against independent reference measurements that these solutions can work. So the advantages, whether we work in 2D or 3D, are obvious, or I kind of already pointed it out, them out to you when introducing the speckle tracking technology, is first of all that we can now get this angle dependency out of the picture. So that makes it possible with fewer acquisitions to actually assess all LV segments in terms of the three components of deformation: radial, longitudinal, and circumferential. With the Doppler technique, we could only get the longitudinal component for all LV segments, and the other components we could only get in a couple of segments. Now, with the tracking technology, we can effectively get all components in all segments. With 2D, we need to do a couple of acquisitions, different imaging views. With 3D, if it works, it should come out just from one single recording. Secondly, the advantage is that the tracking is intrinsic, and therefore it speeds up analysis time significantly. And I think that's the major benefit of this technology, that it really speeds up analysis. So it makes it much more possible or feasible for a clinician to do this bedside and wait for the results. Doppler, for sure, was not, or at least not the way it was implemented. So it's not surprising if I, 2 years ago or 3 years ago, did a PubMed search to see a lot of publications on the topic of 2D speckle tracking. And so we see after introduction of the Doppler approach, we had a steady increase in number of publications. But then with the introduction of speckle tracking, Doppler seemed to become outdated and old-fashioned, so there was not too many people working with that anymore. If we extrapolate, I guess we are close to zero publications now. And speckle tracking took off exponentially. Now, the title was What If We Contrast Them? And whether there would be any benefit in maybe using the best of both worlds. And so that's what I try to look into now. So now we have these two techniques. We have Doppler and we have speckle tracking. And the question is, how competitive are they? Do they actually give us the exact same thing, but maybe one in a more elegant manner than the other? First of all, they do not give us the exact same thing. When I started off with introducing strain to you, I said, well, it's the relative change in length. So where we have the instantaneous lengthening expressed to the original length of the object. That definition is definitely true, and it's the Lagrangian formulation of the strain. So where we take a fixed reference point throughout the entire deformation process. An alternative way of expressing strain is to say I'll take my instantaneous lengthening relative to the instantaneous length that the object had just a moment before my measurement. And if we do that, then we end up with what is called the engineering strain or natural strain. And if you go through the mathematics, I won't do that here, but if you're interested, it's in a paper I wrote quite a while ago. Actually, by Doppler, if you just do the Doppler velocity gradients, you end up with natural strain values. While speckle tracking is the way it has been implemented, and it's a choice that has been made, gives you the Lagrangian formulation. So there is no reason to panic, because of course these two equations relate in a very easy manner. So if you measure one, you can easily compute the other. But it's important to remember that if you just do the Doppler velocity gradient, you do not end up with the Lagrangian strains, but you rather end up with the natural one. And so if we want to be consistent, we have to do this conversion prior to reporting the values. So that's a problem, but it's easily circumvented because we use the equation and problem solved. Now, if we look more closely, in fact, Doppler and speckle tracking measure two different things. They don't measure the exact same. Doppler, it measures the instantaneous velocity in one frame, and then kind of assumes that the velocity remains constant until we do a new measurement in the next frame. So we assume that in between the recordings, in between two frames in our acquisition, there is no acceleration, no directional change of the velocity, no amplitude change of the velocity. So it really means we measure instantaneous velocity, and then we kind of extrapolate that velocity to know the displacement and to know where the piece of tissue has moved in the next frame, assuming there is no acceleration in the meanwhile. Speckle tracking, on the other hand, we have a speckle in one frame. We see that same speckle appear, hopefully the same speckle appear in the next frame. So we do our block matching or whatever process. So we measure the displacement of the speckle from one frame to the next. So what we obtain is the mean displacement, or the displacement between these two frames. And of course, we know the time interval between these two measurements. So if we differentiate with respect to time, then we obtain the mean velocity of that speckle between the two frames. So you see how we get actually two different things. One is the mean velocity, irrespective of acceleration profile. The other one is really an instantaneous velocity, where we assume there is no acceleration in order to get the displacements. And so, of course, as frame rate increases, so the time lag between the measurements is getting narrower, the two will come closer together. But intrinsically, especially at lower frame rates, there can be a discrepancy between the two values just because of this. Now, if we look closely to both systems, the speckle tracking, as I've been describing it, and the Doppler, then we actually see that the Doppler measures the time lag between two subsequent recordings based on the RF signal. So this fast oscillating signal, I'm sure Olivier will have shown signals like it. And so based on the RF signal, which is relatively high frequency, we try to detect small time lags or phase shifts of the signal. On the other hand, that signal we use to reconstruct a B-mode image by, and one of the first steps we do is the demodulation process. So we throw out a high frequency component and we just look at the envelope signal. And that signal we color encode in our B-mode image. So it's a much lower frequency signal, which means that intrinsically it's less sensitive to motion. And that seems very natural if we think of optics or whatever. The higher the frequency, the shorter the wavelength, the better the discrimination power of our imaging technique. And so here as well, if we have a higher frequency, the small motion can more easily be detected than if we work with a low frequency. So speckle tracking, the way it has been implemented, shows advantages. I went through all of these. But it again comes at the cost of sensitivity. And so as far as I know, there is not too much data on that. When speckle tracking was originally introduced, we tried a small study to try to give some credibility to the statement that I just made. So we took a set of patients, so 50 patients with acute infarction. And we try to detect abnormal strain curves at the segmental level, where we then try to say, well, this segment is likely infarcted or not, and we use MR delayed announcement as a reference. And so from that small study with a lot of limitations, but from that small study, we did indeed see, as theoretically may be expected, that the Doppler-based approach was more sensitive and specific than the speckle tracking-based approach. And again, I think the underlying reason is the fact that we work with RF or envelope signals. So being more sensitive to motion or not. So if we know that, why don't we use both? And that was in the title, Doppler speckle tracking or both. So yes, why not both? We could say, well, Doppler is very good in the axial motion estimate, we have this fast oscillating signal, and even a small phase shift we can quite accurately pick up. So why don't we use Doppler to do the axial motion estimate? But Doppler is insensitive to the lateral velocity component. So given that boundary condition, let's then use speckle tracking for the lateral component. And so we kind of take the best of both worlds. And that's exactly what the team in Trondheim did, again, now more than 10 years ago. They had some initial clinical studies where they indeed showed that this approach did a very good job, that it worked very well. But that's, as far as I know, that's where it ended. I have not seen follow-up studies using that same technology, maybe because the PhD students involved in that project graduated and moved out, so the know-how or the momentum got lost. And as far as I know, none of the companies really picked this up. But there seems to be, it seems to make much sense to try to use both at the same time. Now, this slide I showed before, and so I said, because we work with RF in grayscale, we're less sensitive to motion for speckle tracking. But if we continue to reason along that line, then it means that if we want to pick up motion, we have to make sure that there is sufficient motion between two frames. If two frames are too similar, then if it's only a fraction of the wavelength, so it's a small phase shift at the RF level, then the envelope signal will have a lot of difficulties seeing that motion, just because they are so similar and the displacement of the envelope is very small. So in fact, we should not work for speckle tracking on frame rates that are too high, because we may, from one frame to the next, see no motion at all. But then in the end, if you accumulate, there is actually a lot of motion. But you would not detect any, because between two subsequent frames, you say, oh, I don't see any motion. So in fact, we have to limit the time resolution of the data set. And so again, speckle tracking, as I said, has advantages, but it comes at the cost of the time resolution of the data set. And so this is what we typically see when we worked with the Doppler approach. We had a 1D motion estimate only. We had angle dependency, the tracking issues, so maybe a bit cumbersome. But we worked at 200 hertz typically, 180 hertz maybe. So we worked at fairly high time resolution. When we moved to speckle tracking, because of the reasons I just said, we kind of compromised the time resolution to 60 hertz typically. And now if we move to 3D, we compromised it even more and we went to 20, 25 hertz. So whether it's worthwhile remains a bit of a question, I think, in general, to make that compromise. And it could well be that one or the other is better in different conditions or circumstances. So maybe this to choose for one or the other technique could depend on the application you have in mind. Now, importantly, I think, however, is that most people have started to look at strain with the speckle tracking technology. It comes out in a more natural way, maybe, as the quality of the... No, sorry. But if we look at strain, and we did like an animal study to see what it more relates to in terms of cardiac physiology, we showed that strain is primarily determined by arterial elastance here, so it's a measure of the loading condition of the heart. So the more you load on the heart, the lower the strain. And the amount of load on the muscle is apparently the most predictive of the amount of strain measured in the muscle, not the intrinsic ability of the muscle to develop force and to contract. On the other hand, if we look at the strain rate, this was obviously a Doppler-based study, then we did see indeed that strain rate primarily correlated with the gold standard, the invasive gold standard of contractile function of the heart, which is the preload recruitable stroke work. So in that sense, strain rate seems to be a better parameter than strain. And I said that in the Doppler literature, we typically reported on the peak strain rate during the ejection phase or during systole. But as the time resolution of our data set got worse with the introduction of speckle tracking, 2D and particularly 3D, it becomes very difficult, if not impossible, to measure the peak systolic strain rate correctly. Obviously, and that's what is shown here, if you start subsampling, this is actually velocity trace, but the same would hold true for strain rate. If you start subsampling it, well, you may get a crude idea of the overall profile, but the true value, peak value, you would not resolve and you may miss. And so, again, maybe that's a bit problematic, I think, for the speckle tracking approach, where we compromise the time resolution and we therefore do not have access to the parameter that may be the better one to measure in practice. And even worse, it even got, in my opinion, it almost got forgotten. If you talk about strain rate, people look at you as if you're a bit crazy or definitely old-fashioned. Now, I said it's the result of working with speckle tracking. And maybe that statement is not entirely true. It's a result of working with speckle tracking the way it was implemented on the current systems or in the current commercial solutions. Because the speckle tracking was done on the grayscale data set. So we lost the sensitivity. We need relatively large interframe motions in order to pick it up correctly. But of course, that grayscale image is reconstructed from an underlying RF data set. And so if the speckles are preserved on the grayscale, yeah, they need to be preserved on the RF data set as well. In fact, when I explained about speckle preservation, I did it on the RF data and not on the grayscale data. So rather than trying to track speckles on the grayscale, we could say, well, let's try to track it on the RF level. And so that's actually the approach that many academics have taken. There is a lot of implementations available as well. I have listed some teams there, but there is definitely others, as it states at the end. The principle is the exact same. You take a kernel of an RF pattern, not a grayscale pattern, and you try to find that RF pattern somewhere in a neighborhood. And in our initial implementation, that RF pattern was a 1D pattern that we looked for in a 2D window. Later publications showed that if you go to a 2D RF window, it markedly improves the result. But bottom line is that we could do the speckle tracking on the RF level. Obviously, the advantage would be that we increase the sensitivity to small motion. The disadvantage is also obvious. We end up with much larger data sets than the grayscale data sets, and so it comes at a high computational cost. And so I think that's the main reason that the current commercial solutions are on the B-mode data sets, because that's a lot faster and time is limited for everyone, particularly clinicians, so they do not want to wait for 10 minutes to get the strain curve. It needs to be there. Now, if we accept that this RF tracking could be a better option, then indeed we have also shown in animal settings that it nicely picks up again against gold standard invasive measurements. And so that's we did more than 10 years ago. Now the restriction there is that, of course, we have to be careful in the sense that the tracking will still work if we make sure that the frame rate is high enough. So speckles are being preserved, I discussed that before. But of course, they will decorrelate faster at an RF level. So if we want to do this speckle tracking on the RF level, then we have to make sure that the data set is definitely of high time resolution. And when we did this work in 2004, the system was running at 160 Hertz. So in that sense, I refer back to the presentation of Mathieu Pernod yesterday. The fast imaging technology that is entering the field, or has entered the field, is definitely maybe another rationale to reopen this line of research on RF-based speckle tracking, because that will enable us to get the high time resolution that we would need. Okay, more pitfalls. Speckle tracking also is fairly sensitive to noise. And so typically you do get to see, and Damien also gave examples of that, you do get to see these nicely space-time smooth velocity vector fields. In reality, that's not what you get. What you do get is something noisy like this, or even noisier. And then you kind of impose space-time continuity in order to get something smooth out that looks visually attractive. Of course, that means that we start inserting prior knowledge into our velocity vector field. And that process is called regularization. And there is a lot of options on how to do that. And so it remains a challenge, of course, to know which prior is correct and which one is appropriate. And there is then this difficult balance to make between how much do you stick to the true measurement and how much do you lean towards the prior knowledge that you put in. So you have to make a compromise between noise and smoothness. Now, in practice, that means for the current speckle tracking solutions, there is quite a bit of smoothing going on, that the effective sample volume is relatively large. So I don't think we should expect to measure at a very small scale, but we roughly, I don't have solid evidence for this, but it's more like my gut feeling or intuition. Roughly, we are having a resolution competitive or comparable to the standard 16 segment model. So it's fairly crude resolution due to all the smoothing that is required. And so differences at a smaller scale should be interpreted carefully. Of course, this introducing of different priors by different implementations will also lead to more variability between implementations. So there was intrinsically a lot of design choices that I discussed. Is it at the RF level or grayscale? How do we do the subsample interpolation and so on? But also at this level, once you have your velocity field out, how are we going to smooth it? And how are we going to make it visually attractive or deduce meaningful parameters from it? So there is a lot of reason for variability. And that's also what has been reported in several publications. I just picked out one here that show that if you do a measurement with one implementation, you cannot compare it with the measurement done in the same patient with another implementation. And that's, of course, very annoying. And the noise level and the smoothing that is required is playing an important role in that. So ideally, we would have better motion estimators. And particularly, as I said, Doppler is excellent in doing the axial component. But maybe we should try to get better estimates in the lateral component. And again, I'll hold for 1 second here to see whether you're all still with me or whether you have questions or remarks. No? Yeah, go ahead.
About the elementary of the speckle tracking. If you have a homogeneous tissue, I don't know, for a given pathology, your elementary, the element that you move could be found in different places in the box that you fix.
Yeah.
How does the method?
So you would get noise in your data set. And so actually, in one of the next slides, I'll come back to that. So how to deal with the fact that you can have several minima or optima in your similarity metric. In its straightforward implementation, you just take the best, even if it's not the one that you should have picked. You take the overall optimum. And then retrospectively, you say, OK, let's smooth things out. But of course, it seems wiser to do that during the motion estimation process itself, and
especially
to consider several of the optima.
And maybe other pathologies that could be, I mean, a part of the tissue that is more or less homogeneous, or where it's not, the pattern is not singular, I would say.
Yeah. Damien.
I have a comment regarding the frame rate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you rightly say that the frame rate should not be too high to get a good speckle tracking. You mentioned 60 hertz, 60 frames per second to get the undercrate estimate of the speckle tracking, right?
Yeah, but that's what's currently typically done. Yeah. I'm not saying that if you have higher frame rate that it would fail, but...
But I think that one of the reasons is that is because most of the software use the block matching method. Mm-hmm. And with the block matching method, you have a bias towards the nearest value.
Yeah.
And, so if we use something like, something different like optical flow, probably, with the envelope.
Yeah.
And with high frame rate, it should be good enough to find a good estimate.
Yeah, and so I fully
probably
agree.
One of the bias is because any software is based on block matching. Whatever the similarity measure.
Yes.
So this is also one of the reasons.
No, I fully agree with that. And in fact, well, I see I'm probably going to run late, so I'm probably making a shortcut at some point in the presentation. But that's what the remainder of the presentation is about. Yes. So, and for sure, optical flow, optical flow is mentioned towards the end.
So,
no, but it's good to try to interact as we go. Okay. So, because I see it's 12:20, I'm not sure what time I started. Sorry.
We have
10 more minutes. Okay. So, in the remainder, I'll go fast. and in fact, what we would need is better lateral motion estimates. And I'll just elucidate on some approaches that could give us that. But as I say, because of time, I'll probably need to go a little bit fast through that. So the fundamental problem in getting good lateral motion estimates is the fact that our lateral resolution is not very good, and that we do not have a carrier wave in the lateral direction. So in the axial direction, we have this high-frequency wobbling signal, the RF signal, that we can then very precisely track. But in the lateral direction, we don't have this. And so if we were to create such a laterally oscillating sound field, and we would have this lateral oscillating signal, then we could do the exact same as in Doppler, but now orthogonal to the image line. So try to pick up phase shifts of this oscillating signal left-right rather than looking at this smoothly or slowly changing envelope signal. And so there is quite a bit of literature on this, which is called transverse oscillations. And as you can see, you do get higher lateral frequency content, so you get faster wobbling speckle in the lateral direction. And in essence, you could do it in a very simple way, by transmitting a plane wave and then using receive apodization just using two Gaussians. So it appears that if you have two receivers next to one another, and as you know, if you like put two coherent sources in water or whatever, then you get a nice interference pattern. And so that's exactly what you try to do there. You try to create two coherent sources during a receive. And so you could anticipate that if you get this better lateral resolution, or you get some kind of carrier frequency in the lateral direction, that if you go to your motion estimates, that it shows and that you do a better job in estimating the lateral motion. And so this is a fairly old slide that I took from Hervé Liebgott's work in Creatis. There has been a lot of more activities later on, all of them kind of demonstrating that indeed, if you do this properly, you could gain and get better lateral motion estimates. Now, as always, the story is more complex. And so, without going into too much detail, but there is this theoretical framework that was developed at the Duke University that gives you an estimate of the lower bound of the variance in your motion estimates. And that lower bound is then expressed as a number of image characteristics, such as the SNR, the spectral content, the decorrelation. And if you use that framework and start to think a little bit more in depth about what is then beneficial or not, because if you create these lateral oscillations and you have a lateral carrier frequency, you obviously will increase the spectral content in the lateral direction, so this would get better. But at the same time, for a certain amount of motion, you expect your decorrelation to increase. So also this one would go up. And so it becomes a bit tricky to understand when does one do better, and so when do you actually gain from the lateral oscillations in order to get better lateral motion estimates. And so that Brecht in the lab worked on last year, where you see that it really depends on SNR for one, but also on the frame rate. And so if you work at moderate frame rates, like 90 frames per second, given a certain motion velocity or velocity of the heart, a typical velocity of the heart, about 10 centimeters a second, in fact, it remains better to work with the regular acquisition, the focused acquisition, mostly because then you still restrict the amount of decorrelation. As you move up in frame rate, and so you have less motion between frames, the benefit of going to this transverse oscillation increases. Now, this comes back to the question that you asked. So what if you have somewhere a false positive peak? So you have a better match in another location just by bad luck. So for the moment, most people just do all of these corrections a posteriori. So they do the initial estimates, they get a noisy velocity field, and then you try to filter it somehow. But there has been indeed more clever implementations saying, well, let's look at the possible candidates. So there is multiple optima in our similarity metric, and try to use that map of optima together with the boundary condition on smoothness, for example, here of the displacement field, in order to, in the end, in some kind of cost function and optimization process, come up with the best solution. In elastography, that was introduced a long time ago, I tried a bit to use the same concept during my own PhD, so to try to make sure that things are spatially continuous and consistent. And very recently, the team in Technion in Israel proposed a very similar method, so where they said, okay, let's consider all the possible candidate optima, and then use that together with a constraint on how the overall displacement field can look like in order to find in an optimization scheme one best solution. And they refer to that as the K-SAT algorithm. So as they use the K nearest options or the K best optima. Now, of course, if we think of such an optimization scheme, we very quickly think of image registration methods. And so for sure the people that come from an image processing perspective, they will know of these registration methods. And so they are very close to what I was just describing by combining block matching or local motion estimates with some constraints on overall spatial distribution of the motion estimates. So for time reasons, I'll go very quickly through this slide and just show the animation. So in such a freeform deformation model or non-rigid registration approach, essentially what you do is you kind of impose a grid on top of the on one image, and you try to move the grid points and therefore or thereby deform the underlying image, and try to deform that grid in such a way that it matches your target image, which would be the next image in the image sequence. So that seems to work pretty well. This is in a sheep using the same system. On the left, it's the commercially available speckle tracking algorithm. On the right, it's our own implementation of such an elastic registration process. And so if you go through an elaborate validation study, you see that against an invasive gold standard measure, you see that they give very competitive results, but that, in our implementation at least, particularly the radial component gained from this. Again, we could combine the best of both worlds. So if we now say we will replace the speckle tracking with some registration procedure, why, again, forget about what Doppler could give us? And so that's what Antonio did a couple of years ago, together with Bart and Mathieu. At UPF, so saying, well, we could use our motion estimates from the B-mode images through a registration process. So you could call it a modified speckle tracking algorithm or a more intrinsically smoothed displacement estimate. and combine that with tissue Doppler velocities and put that in the same optimization process as the constraint. And so he showed, this is on simulated data sets, that indeed by doing that, by bringing information from both worlds, the grayscale world and the Doppler world, that you gained in terms of performance. Of course, all of that could be translated to 3D, so I'm going to go quickly through it. Several implementations of that. We also validated that in the same animal experiments, so that works pretty well. And so there again, also in 3D, you would gain from using the best of both worlds. And so that's what Antonio reported upon last year. Again, using the 3D B-mode motion field in combination with the Doppler velocity estimates in that same volumetric data set. Maybe a final say on this. The registration process. I said before that with speckle tracking, we started working at the grayscale level, while the, if we want to keep it sensitive to small motion, it may be better to work on the RF data set. And so with this registration process, again, we were now pulled towards working with the grayscale images. But again, there is no fundamental reason to believe that we could not try to use the same kind of registration methods on the RF data sets, the underlying RF data sets. And so this is recent work from our own lab. This is just the synthetic models that we move or deform in different ways, and where we try to compare the estimates that we obtained through RF-based non-rigid image registration with the ones obtained from a state-of-the-art block matching approach. And so in the middle panel, on the left, you see the ground root motion fields. I don't get my eye here. On the left, you get the ground root motion fields for the axial and for the lateral components. This is in polar space, so it's a rectangle, but you see a different shape here in polar space. But importantly, you see the non-rigid image registration solution, which is very close to the ground root. If you compare it to the block matching approach, axial, they are, let's say, competitive, but laterally, we do a much better job by doing that registration approach. Okay, now I'm going to skip a few slides and just go to the optical flow method, just because it was raised as a potential solution to some of the problems we face with block matching. And for sure that's true. So we could say let's go to this fundamental equation of preservation of intensities and work with optical flow. One way of solving that equation has been proposed again by the Unzer team in Lausanne many years ago. So by minimizing this energy functional, where we do some kind of weighting if we want to select a certain image in the part of the image domain. And so we assume an affine transformation model, and the region of interest that we could try to estimate our motion field on using the optical flow could be pre-selected to be the myocardium, exactly the myocardium, so that whatever sits outside of the wall would not contribute to our affine transformation model estimate. It has several advantages, but one of the advantages could also be, and that's very recently now reported, since the day before yesterday, in fact, in this journal, that you could also go to a localized version of it. So you could make this mask not a global one for the entire myocardium, but really zoom into it locally, and you get only in that certain region an affine transformation model that is valid for that region. And so it comes very close to a polyaffine solution that has also been proposed by Olivier and Mathieu and some of the students here. But it's an optical flow solution that could indeed, especially if we get high frame rate data sets, be of benefit to get more robust estimates. And these are just some of the results. Okay, so that's where I will conclude. I think I walked through different motion estimators. The ones that were originally used and that have been used a lot in the clinical setting, I have highlighted in green. So the Doppler-based approach and the speckle tracking approach. I would both of them classify in the category of the direct motion estimators. Next to these two, we also have the vector Doppler that has been suggested as a possible candidate. We have the optical flow that I was just referring to. We could think of the lateral modulation in order to improve the lateral motion estimates. And then a second category that has been less or not used in a more clinical environment are the ones that do the motion estimation in a more iterative process, either through block matching using a cost function or using these free-form deformation models or elastic registration approaches. Now, to come back to the question that was posed in the title slide, do we use Doppler or speckle tracking or both? In a way, personally, I think that the discrimination between what we call Doppler and what we do not call Doppler, but something else, has become very vague. In the end, they all try to do motion estimation by looking at time shifts or phase shifts. And so when you talk about Doppler and when you talk about non-Doppler methods, it's not always obvious to me. I guess traditionally Doppler was mostly associated to phase shift estimators, so that you really locally try to estimate a phase shift, while the other methods did not. They rather tried to estimate time delays or time shifts. But again, I think the ambiguity between the two is there. And for sure, both of these approaches have their strengths and weaknesses. And so, to me, it only seems logic that we try to exploit the best of both worlds, like in a few publications that effectively did that and tried to combine both data sets. But that's not what is the current commercially available method. So that's where I will end. I'm sorry if I ran a little late, but I'll be open for further discussions later on if you like. Thank you.
It's this question about the transverse oscillation, the last paper from
Brecht,
when you were a co-author. I was wondering whether you use the to estimate. So you create transverse oscillation, and then which estimator will you use from these transverse oscillation images?
We always use the elastic registration framework. So okay. We always use the same motion estimator, so not to be biased by the motion estimator itself.
Okay, so the transversation here was a way to improve the lateral resolution.
Yes.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. But in fact, in that paper, we only focused on this theoretical formulation.
Yes, exactly. Yeah,
so it's like if you accept the assumptions made to build the theory, then the amount of jitter in your estimates comes out analytically, and then you see that there is this trade-off between pulsed or transverse oscillated wave fields.
Question, because when we try a transverse oscillation with a phased array, it is much more difficult than with a linear array.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
Mostly in vivo.
Yes,
so
absolutely.
That's why I was wondering whether you already try in vivo with these techniques.
No, and we also thought, well, the transition, let's say, from linear array to phased will be trivial or not too complicated, but it turned out to be very difficult. Okay. And so we didn't get a good way around it. And I must admit, we kind of abandoned the idea now.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Thank you for your talk, and sorry everyone as well. I have one comment and one question. So the comment is that in my experience, the biggest problem to measure anything in the heart is clutter.
Clutter, yes.
So I'd like, and I would just suggest everybody in this audience to pay a lot of attention to clutter. The person who solves the clutter problem in cardiac imaging, he just found the holy grail.
That's my comment. It's a very good comment, yes. I should have mentioned it during
So in a lot of cases, you just can't see anything in the lateral wall, and it's just because of clutter. The question I asked you personally, but maybe it's good for everyone too as well, is that in my experience, and you alluded to it, is the only advantage of using IF versus image is to get a good strain rate curve, because the velocity curve and the strain curves, they're kind of low spatial resolution, low temporal resolution. You don't need that much of an accuracy. Mm-hmm. It really makes a difference when you get the strain rate. But now nobody uses strain rate because it's too noisy. So what would be the argument for using strain rate in the future? What would be, you know, what would make it go through?
My argument for using strain rate?
I mean, you already had one example. Is there more?
That would be my main argument, so that it seems to be more related to intrinsic contractile properties of the myocardium. And so ultimately, when strain imaging started off, that's what the target was, to really measure local myocardial function. And so if we want to assess the local function, then it seems better to work with strain rate. And so there was this one example, indeed, from an animal setting, and you could criticize whether that's translatable to a clinical setting or not. But there is also several reports that show that strain rate as a parameter is a better classifier of disease than strain. For example, I popped up the paper from Ingle as she combined both speckle tracking and Doppler. She did a big stress echo study where she also showed that strain rate, in fact, was the better parameter to measure in order to detect inducible ischemia. Also, we now more recently, using some of machine learning approaches applied to all of these curves, we see that if we feed the machine with strain rate curves, it comes up with better classification than if we feed it with strain curves. So although the traces themselves look noisy for the human reader and are therefore maybe not as much liked by clinicians, there seems to be more intrinsic information in there. So if we could get rid of this in somehow, then maybe that would be the way forward. And just to comment on that, that would be the only advantage to go to Doppler. I don't think so. I think also the some of the block matching or optical flow or whatever could be done on the high frame rate 2D or 3D data sets if we could acquire them and be able to give us the strain rate in 2 or 3D, which would be even better, I think.
It's maybe a comment further on. I mean, I fully agree with Jan said, with what Jan said, but first of all, you have to keep in mind that strain and strain rate are related to temporal interval. So that's one thing, which means that if you would look at the full strain profile, you would get the strain rate information also. Now, the question is, when you then extract a value from it, as currently is done in literature, like maximum strain or systolic strain or maximal strain rate or whatever you take, then you're going to look at one particular thing. And then it just means something different. When you look at strain, the amount of strain, the maximal strain, given a certain geometry of the ventricle, tells you what the stroke volume is. So you're actually looking in a way to stroke volume and how stroke volume is generated in different directions. That's what you actually do. That contains some information, but as we know, it's very dependent on heart rate. Strain goes down at higher heart rate and things like that. So strain has a lot of limitations with that regard. And also, mostly the volume or the stroke volume, we're not that much interested in. While you take the strain rate, that gives you the balance between the contractile force and the loading, because it's how fast deformation can take place. And actually, mostly this is what we're interested in clinically. Do we have enough contractile force to overcome the loading, where you can even have an increased load or you have a decreased contractility? So intrinsically, if you take one value, and then I fully agree with Jan, what you want to look at is contractility versus load, and then strain rate gives it. The problem is that indeed, technically, because it's mostly a derivative, it's much more noisy. So in that sense, it's like that's why people go to strain, but intrinsically, strain rate would answer most of our questions. Sometimes strain is interesting also. Huh? It really depends on what you do. Especially for strain, I see much more the relation between longitudinal versus circumferential strain, for example. That contains information rather than the strain itself. And so when we look at strain kind of, well, curves, values, whatever, or when we train cardiologists, what we say is like it's not the value of the strain which contains the information, it's the profile. Because the value will change, and also the value of strain rate will change because of noise. But the patterns for different diseases are actually very recognizable. And that's also why now there's more and more information that machine learning, for example, is really starting to help, because then you look at the whole pattern. And so there's a lot of things that are important here, but strain rate at this moment as a value measured is clearly undervalued.
And maybe the last comment on that is that, in fact, also if you look at the basic physiology in muscle strips, the parameter that they try to measure there, and that is linked to the intrinsic contractile properties of that piece of muscle, is the velocity of shortening if you extrapolate it to zero load. And so the strain rate, in fact, is very close to this velocity of shortening that has been used a lot in basic physiology studies.
Only quick one to the loading. In fact, you mentioned it now as well. I didn't get the relationship so much. So, what does it actually mean, loading, to load the heart? In fact,
so essentially, it's how much force you have to overcome in order to be able to eject blood. And so, the easiest correlate is just if you think of your skeletal muscle. I can lift my arm very easily like this, so I contract, I deform the muscle, and therefore I move my arm. But if I put a weight of 200 kilograms on my hand, I can contract as much as I want, but unfortunately I'm not strong enough, and I would not be able to lift it. And so although I have contractile function of my biceps, I would not be able to deform it because I cannot lift the weight. And that's the exact same in the heart. So if the loading is too large, if the resistance to output is too large, it could become very difficult for the muscle to deform.
Yeah. Okay. And now this loading, so is this basically caused by, I can imagine, by arteriosclerosis? That
for example,
the arteries are getting filled with plaque, so the heart has to...
There is a lot of disease processes that would result in higher loading. And one of the big diseases is aging. So it's not maybe a real disease, but just getting older makes your vessels stiffer, and it makes it more difficult for the heart to eject blood into the vasculature.
But also like you have pressure loading, which Jan refers to, but you also have volume loading.
So load is
what the heart needs to do with regards to pressure and volume output. So and any change there will change the conditions in which the heart will contract.
Lunchtime, so we will follow our students for the way to the country. Thank you very much again.
Innovation and you, Philips.